unexpected effect of plastic pollution in the seas. Coastal plants and animals have found an unusual way to survive far from land. Many species have colonized plastic waste. The Great Pacific Garbage Patch unexpectedly turned out to be a new habitat for life. It now contains species never seen so far from land. The changes associated with plastic waste in the seas and oceans go far beyond just eating them by animals. It turns out that the waste has created an opportunity to expand the habitat of coastal species, says Lindsay Harum, lead author of the paper on changes in marine biogeography, which appeared in the journal Nature Communications. Islands of plastic waste form as surface currents drive pollutants from coastal areas into the ocean. There, garbage is held back by other currents and accumulates over time. There are at least five similar islands of waste in the world. The Great Pacific Garbage Patch is located between California and Hawaii and contains the most floating plastic. Experts estimate that there may be as many as 79,000 tons spread over an area of over 1.5 million square kilometers. The researchers also point out that garbage stain can be a misleading term, because a large part of the pollution consists of microplastics that cannot be seen with the naked eye. Now it turns out that along with garbage, organisms living in coastal areas are also being dragged into the ocean. The authors of the study call these communities living on garbage neopelagic. The word comes from neo, which means new, and pelagial, which is the technical term for the waters of the open ocean. Scientists first began to suspect that coastal species may be using plastic to survive in the open ocean after the 2011 tsunami in Japan. Then they discovered that almost 300 species had sailed almost the entire Pacific Ocean on the remains in a few years. However, until now, confirmed sightings of coastal species on plastic floating in the open ocean have been rare. Lindsay Harum decided to investigate the matter, which joined forces with the Ocean Voyages Institute, a non-profit organization that collects plastic pollution during sailing trips. University of Hawaii oceanographers Jan Hafner and Nikolai Maximenko also participated in the study. The advantage of the Ocean Voyages Institute is that their sailing ships do not emit any pollutants. Going to the middle of the ocean in a fuel-powered boat would require a lot of energy. That's why they use heavy-duty sailing vessels to remove plastics from the open ocean, notes Harum. In 2020, Ocean Voyages Institute founder Mary Crowley and her team managed to collect a record 103 tons of plastic and other debris from the North Pacific. Some of the samples were sent to Harum, who analyzed them at a marine species laboratory. The researcher found that many coastal species, including sea anemones, seaweeds and amphipods, not only survived but thrived on plastic waste. For scientists studying the seas and oceans, the very existence of this new open ocean community is a paradigm shift. Until now, the open ocean was uninhabitable for coastal organisms, says Marine Lab Manager Greg Ruiz, partly because of the lack of suitable habitats, and partly because we thought it was a food desert, adds the scientist. The new discovery shows that both concepts turned out to be false. Plastic provides a habitat for coastal organisms that somehow find food. Scientists still speculate about where the food in the food desert might come from. Researchers also note that coastal visitors can disrupt native ocean ecosystems that have remained intact for thousands of years. Dozens of species live in open water and also colonize floating waste. It is not known how the emergence of new coastal neighbors may affect the ecosystem. Coastal species are in direct competition with ocean species, Haram explains. They compete for space. They compete for resources. And these interactions are very poorly understood, he adds. This poses a threat from invasive species. After the 2011 tsunami, scientists were able to observe how organisms from Japan ended up in North America. Huge colonies floating in the open ocean over the years can act as a reservoir of organisms, giving them the opportunity to invade new shores. These other coasts are not just urbanized areas, but also more remote places, protected areas, the Hawaiian Islands, national parks, Ruiz enumerates. Scientists still don't know how common these neopelagic communities are and whether they can sustain themselves or even exist beyond the Great Pacific Garbage Patch. It is known, however, that the world's dependence on plastic continues to grow. Researchers estimate that the total amount of plastic waste in the world could reach more than 25 billion tons by 2050. Given the increasingly stronger and more frequent storms that will occur as a result of climate change, the authors expect that even more plastic will end up in the seas and oceans. Consequently, colonies of coastal creatures in the open sea are likely to expand. This long-overlooked side effect of plastic pollution could soon transform life on land and in the sea, according to new research. Climbing roses, planting and care in the open. Climbing roses are undoubtedly one of the most beautiful and elegant plants that can be planted in your garden. They are able to bloom even throughout the season, and the climbing branches give a lot of freedom in creating aesthetic shapes that will perfectly match any style of the garden. What's more, plants are characterized by amazing qualities of adapting to the environment. Just choose the right variety adapted to the given conditions and you can grow a rose in virtually any place in the garden. Before planting the rose, put it in water for a maximum of a few hours. The exception is when the shoots appear wrinkled, which may indicate a lack of turgor. Then put it in water for a long time. In a situation where it is not possible to plant the seedlings right away, the plant should be pitted, i.e. planted in any place with properly prepared soil and watered thoroughly. Planting looks identical to pitting. The plant needs a loose, nutrient-rich soil. It is worth sprinkling cattle manure under the freshly planted rose. The plant should be placed deep enough to cover all the roots without bending them too much. The soil can be mixed with peat and plant substrate. Then you need to mound the seedling for a few weeks, i.e. sprinkle the shoots to additionally protect it from external conditions when it adapts in the ground. A climbing rose should always have something to climb on. Therefore, at the planting stage or over time, when the shoots start to grow, it is worth getting the appropriate mesh, stakes or anything else, after which the shoots will grow into the shape that interests us. Plant care is simple and always comes down to the same thing. Watering the plant should be carried out rarely, when there is a drought. In the fall, care should be taken to fertilize properly. In addition, shoots should be trimmed in spring, which will allow for much better flowering during the season. To protect the plant from frost, it can be covered with agrotextile. Although it should also be noted that climbing roses have high frost resistance.